Muy buenos días a todos. I would like to thank the organizing committee for giving me the opportunity of present the results of radio interferometric observations that we carried out last year in September towards using the Australian Telescope Compact Array towards the source IRAS 15445. This is the outline of the talk. The source is classified as a pulsing UV star. It's classified as a pulsing UV star. It has been observed at OH based on the OH based emission has been detected, having a very irregular line profile. But still, it has been used to define the systemic velocity of the source at minus 150 kilometers per second. Water-based emission trails in a larger velocity range than the one defined by the OH measure has been also observed.
That is why this source is classified also as a water fountain.
In 2011, we reported the detection of new observations towards the high-velocity outflow. And we detect some of the water measure emission being with some linear polarization. And we were able, with our new observations, we were able to map the measure emitting region and then combining our results with the previous results of the OH, observation of OH, and non-thermal light prior continuum, we were able to
have a better idea of the distribution
of the emitting regions toward the source. This scale is milliard seconds. And we were at that point very puzzled by this very nice alignment between the non-thermal emission detected, reported by Banks et al. 2009 and our measure feature. In 2011, Regalek was observed the source in the mid-infrared and then playing a bit with the positional error of the instrument in T1-V0. We, just for illustration, we correlated the measure emission that we detect with the north node of the source. And the non-thermal emission was fell on the south lobe of the source, and that was our question: writing a new proposal. What is generating this non-thermal emission? Where is it coming from? Some previous continuum observations towards the source. The source was detected in previous dry continuum observations. Here is the point, 0.8 GHz detection. This is the small point here, this is our source. It was
also detected in 4.8 and 8.6 GHz in 2005. It was observed in 1998, 1999, and also in 2005 in red continuum. All of the observations using ATLAS.
Then, but the question was still there. I mean, we didn't know where the emission was coming from, where it was being generated. Then we wrote a new proposal for ATLAS, and then we got the time. We observed the source for an around of 12 hours using 2 GHz bandwidth center at 22 GHz, 9, 5,
and 2.2 GHz.
We split the things we have like a wide bandwidth, then in order to generate extra points in the spectral energy distribution, we split the bands 2 GHz, 5 GHz, and
9 gigahertz in 2. This is like, I mean, doesn't mean anything. I just want to put it here because I just want to, I want you to know that it is not possible to determine the where is the emission coming from in the lower frequency bands. But in the case of the 22 gigahertz band, we detect, we resolve this elongated emission is about 1.9 arcseconds. It's 1.9 arcseconds. This is the bin at 22 gigahertz, and the contours here are the 5 gigahertz emission. The previous observations were the source. They reported the point -0.8 spectral index with 2 points. Baines et al. Reported a spectral index of -34, and then we confirmed that the origin of the source is a non-thermal emission, is non-thermal, and the spectral index is the spectral index of synchrotron radiation. But to generate synchrotron radiation in a very to generate that synchrotron radiation, you need to basically two things: relativistic particles and one strong magnetic field. Baines et al. They use radiative transfer modeling for fit the emission and the photometry as the mid infrared, and they obtain that the temperature of the star is around 12,000 Kelvin, which is not enough to ionize the quasar. It's not enough to generate a big amount of electrons in the circumstellar envelope. Then, what we suggest is that when the outflow is propagating through the circumstellar envelope, it generates strong shocks, and then the shock is has energy enough to ionize the non-shock gas, and then some of the electrons are trapped on the shock front, on the shock front, and then via Fermi shock acceleration, they are strongly accelerated up to the speed of light velocity. This is the spectral index, the spectral energy distribution that we found. This the blue points represent our observations, and then this emission is characterized by a turnover around 3 gigahertz. Then that could mean that the emission that we detect is has two components, one thermal and one non-thermal. And then keeping that in mind, we did a radiative transfer modeling of the non-thermal radio continuum, assuming this configuration, that the synchrotron emission is generated in the small cylinder here, and it is surrounded by a shell that contains thermal electrons. Then, with this configuration and with these parameters, assuming that the density of the electrons in the thermal electrons is constant, as well as the temperature, we fit our observations, and assuming that the emission is optically thick below 3 gigahertz and above the 3 gigahertz, the synchrotron emission start to dominate the flux. Then we found that the non-thermal component of the emission has a spectral index of -0.6, and assuming that the energy of the emitting region is split between the magnetic field and the relativistic particles, and then minimizing the energy, the total energy with respect to the magnetic field, we found that the minimum magnetic field, using the energy equipartition, we found that the minimum magnetic field and the emitting region has this strength. The distance of the source is not well determined yet. Then we have this dependence of the distance, and assuming that we didn't find any polarization of the radiation, then we don't know, we are not sure of which component of the magnetic field the emission is tracing, but assuming that the toroidal component of the magnetic field, we found that extrapolating that this value to 2 AU at the surface of the star, the magnetic field has to be of this strength. But what about the difference between the previous observations and our observations? Then we think the interpretation that we give to this is, if we assume that the synchrotron component, which is this line here coming down, remains constant between 1998 and our observation 2012, then this difference is due to is because an increase of the density of the electron density in the thermal shell that contains the thermal electron, right? By a factor of 2 in 7 years. That rapid initial increase implies that those electrons could be being generated by the propagation of the shock. Through the circumstellar envelope. Then we have two facts here. We have that the resulting synchrotron emission that we detected correlates very well with the infrared emission detected by Eric Debye, and the calculation that we did of the minimum energy, assuming equipartition of the energy equipartition, is within the energy, the kinetic energy range that Valentin Bourahaval measured using observation of the molecular component of the optimism. Then we suggest that the jet is collimated by a large scale magnetic field, that the jet is shaping the circumstellar envelope of the source, but we still don't know the source of the magnetic field or the launching mechanisms. And since the source is a water fountain, we think that we have to start looking, observing a dryer continuum towards this source in order to see if this is a common phenomena or it's just this isolated source. Thank you very much.
Just a quick observation of the worry. Are you sure that there is no issue with flux losses in the higher frequencies, because that would give the same track?
Flux losses because...
because you're using interferometer, so you resolve all emissions at the scales.
Well, I am not sure of that.
Valentin?
As I told you the other day, the question I think is that to compare your jets with the bipolar alpha detected in carbon monoxide and other lines, I think which is crucial is not the energy but the momentum, because you are dealing with relativistic jets, so the ratio between energy and momentum is not very good. So I think you should try to compare the momentum of both the one and the other. This is, I think, this is the key.
But a comment on what you said is, we don't think this is a relativistic jet. We think it's a high velocity outflow that by Fermi shock acceleration is getting the electrons up to that to relativistic velocity, right? Then, but we for sure have to observe, find a way to observe the molecular component of or H2O say and try to get the mass of the outflows to get the momentum of the outflow.
Thank you. We're going to move to the last talk, contributed talk, that is, of Asymmetrical Planetary Nebula 6. No pressure on the speaker whatsoever. David Clark is going to be talking.